Lord, for the privilege to offer to you, and I pray that your blessing will come upon us. Lord, I pray that you will rebuke the devourer from our midst, Lord. Whatever devouring that is taking place in our families, in our neighborhoods, and to our children, I pray that this devouring will stop. Lord, I pray that you will rebuke dengue from our midst, Lord, that nobody will be having dengue, no cancers, Lord. And Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that this, Lord, thank you that this is a divorce-free zone. So we rebuke any disharmony of marriages. We thank you, Lord, as we offer to you, I pray that you will open heaven's doors on our midst, Lord. We bless you and we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good evening to you. And it's a nice day to, it's a privilege to share God's word with you. And Brother Lalit and Sister Hiranti sends their greetings from Germany. And today we would be looking at a passage of scripture of Jesus healing the man born blind. Now, when today I would be talking to you a little bit on the sight, on the faculty of sight, because we all know that sight is very important for us. You know, sometimes we ask, we had a principal, a warden in our school, who came from the deaf and blind school. And he came and said, if you had the decision, which one to choose, whether you would be blind or whether you would choose to be deaf, what would you choose? You know, many said, I would rather choose to be deaf than blind, you know. But he said, you know, that is the fault, because deaf people are totally cut off from this world. But sight is very important also. Now today, if you can read from John 9 verses 39 to 41, John 9, 39 to 41, Jesus said, for judgment I have come into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may be made blind. Then some of the Pharisees who were with him heard this. Are we blind also? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say we see, therefore your sin remains. Because Jesus came into this world and he said, I have come so that the blind people can see. And then some of the Pharisees said, do you mean that we are blind also? And Jesus said, if you knew that you were blind, you would have no sin, because you understand that you are blind. But you say you see, but you are still blind. So today, we could look at what really is sight and how do we see more, because this is one of the keys for our spiritual life. While we were worshipping here, the Lord showed me of a person who was like blind, you know, who was, both the eyes were covered. And I said, Lord, why are the eyes covered? And the Lord said, this person is blind. So I said, Lord, give me more. Why is this person blind? Is it because of a natural blindness or a spiritual blindness? And the Lord said, no, none of that. But it is blinded by circumstances, which means so many bad things have happened to you. You have no sight for the future. The future seems bleak because there is absolutely no sight. You are blinded by circumstances. Let's read Matthew 6, 22 and 23. Matthew 6, 22 and 23. Shall we read it together? The lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Now, have you ever used a lamp someday in your life? Have you ever used a lamp? Okay, now these are the days that you don't find the normal lamps. You have torches, and sometimes now people use their cell phones for torches, because the torch culture has also gone off. But in those days, there were no torches, no cell phones, they used a lamp. And when will you use a lamp? When it is dark, when there's a power failure. And why do you use a lamp? so that you can see. Now this is the principle that Jesus gave us. People go through dark times. Tell me, dark times. And what are these dark times? These are the times of disappointment, failure, lack, disease. There are so many dark times that we go through. And Jesus says, in these dark times, there is a lamp that you have to light. Now we have heard of the axiom, do not curse the darkness, instead light a candle. Okay? Do not curse the darkness, but light a candle. But Jesus gives us what this candle is. Now according to this scripture, what is the candle that the Lord Jesus wants to give you in your darkest hour? I hope the scripture is there, because I have no scripture in front, so I'm depending that this scripture will be there. Right? Okay, so what is the candle that the Lord Jesus gives you in your dark hour? The eye. What does that mean? In your darkest hour, if you can see, your whole body would be full of light. In your darkest hour, you cannot see anything. Jesus says, how great is that darkness within you, because that is a great darkness. Now today we are going to look at what seeing is really about. Now how many of you, if you are a parent, would know your child will be going in this direction and that direction, and how many of you parents saw the end result of your child before the child actually endeavored on that path? If you saw the end result, maybe your child was good in science and you yourself saw your child as a doctor, or your child was good in something, you saw the end result. How many of you have seen that? I'm sure many would have seen. Now, is that physical seeing, or is that something more to see? There's something more than your physical thing that you see. Now today what we are looking at, how do we really see? Seeing is not only the physical light we see, but it's way beyond what Jesus has planned for us to see. Now let's look at Jeremiah chapter 17 verses 5 to 8. Let's read together. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes the flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. For he shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land which is not inhabited. Now this scripture gives a description of a man or a woman. And what is the description of this man or the woman? This person trusts in man. Now tell me, who is the first person you will trust? Tell me the first person you will trust. You trust yourself. Good if you can trust your wife. But I think you trust yourself first. Good if you can trust your husband, but I think you trust yourself. The first person you can trust is yourself. And this man, his strength is man, and he shall be like a shrub in the desert, and he shall not see what? He shall not see what? He shall not see good coming. Now how many of you are familiar with this in life, that you were so discouraged that even when good came, you didn't acknowledge that it is good. You couldn't see that it was good. I'm sure, I don't want you to lift hands for this, but this is very familiar ground. And what is that state? That is a cursed state. Where when good comes, you cannot acknowledge good, but you are totally blind to the good that has come your way. That is a cursed state. Now this is true of the next verse, is the quite the opposite. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord, for he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river, and shall not see when heat comes, but its leaf will be green, and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. The second type of man is what? He is the man who trusts in God, but he also does not see something. What is that? He does not see when the heat comes. Now, which is good? Which is good? And this man has no fear when heat comes because he has the Lord as his strength. Now today we are going to look at two aspects. That is the side of belief and the side of action. Now repeat with me, side of belief and the side of action. Right? Now the passage, before the passage, I'd like to share one more scripture, 2 Corinthians 5:7, yeah, it's there. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Now this is not talking about your natural senses of seeing light. This is a sight that is a little deeper. And how do we see? We see by faith. Okay, just remember that. We see by faith. We will go into detail today. And let's get to our passage from John chapter 9, verses 1 to 5. John chapter 9, verses 1 to 5. It's there. Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it's day. The night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of this world. Now Jesus was walking with his 12 disciples. And when they were walking through, they see a man who was born blind. And when they saw this man, the disciples were very inquisitive. And the disciples asked, Lord, who sinned, this man or his parents? And they were expecting an answer because they were arguing it cannot be him because he was born blind. If Jesus said, it is because this man sinned, then they would have another question. How did he sin? Because he was born blind. And the next question was this his parents' fault? Now, I think if something bad happens to you, I think we all have this tendency to check. Is it something that we have sinned, or is it the fault of somebody else, our parents? Now, we all go through these notions, right? Now, Jesus had an interesting answer. He said, it is not this man's sin, neither was his parents' sin. Then the disciples asked, then why did this bad thing happen? Now, repeat with me, bad things happen to good people. Right? Bad things happen to good people. If something bad happens to you, that doesn't mean that you are a sinner. Okay? Right. Now, this was the kind of vision that the disciples had. If something bad happens to you, it must be something of your fault. And Jesus had a completely different view of it. What did Jesus say? Jesus said, this man is not blind because his or anybody else's fault. This man is blind so that the works of God can be established in this person. Now Jesus was preoccupied with what? He saw the greatness of God and what God can do in a situation. And Jesus was more concerned to find out what God can do in a situation rather than finding whose fault was it. And this was the kind of seeing that Jesus had. Now today, my brothers and sisters, this is the vision that you also need to get today, is that what God can do about your situation rather than what brought out that situation. Because that is faith. Now spiritual vision is securely anchored in the goodness of God. Your circumstances may change, your symptoms would change, but whatever you're going through, there is one thing that you can lie secure, is the goodness of God over your life. You would have been a new person, you would have been an old person, you would have been a person who has sinned a lot, but there is one thing that you can be assured of. That is the goodness of God that He will bring about in your life. Now the Pharisees had another view. Let's read from John 9:13-16. John 9:13-16. They brought him who formerly was blind to the Pharisees. Now it was a Sabbath when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also asked him again how he had received his sight. He said to them, he put clay on my eyes and I washed and I see. Therefore some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God because he does not keep the Sabbath. Others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? And there was a division among them. The Pharisees, this man was brought to the Pharisees, and they inquired, when was this healing done? And it said, it was on a Sabbath day. To them, Sabbath was a Saturday and a holy day. And the Pharisees said, okay, he broke the Sabbath, he cannot be from God. Not only he cannot be from God, he is a sinner because he broke the Sabbath. Then the others questioned him, how can a sinner bring about a healing to a blind man? And there was a division, a controversy, two schools of thought were there. One said he is a righteous man, other person said no, he's a sinner. Now brothers and sisters, what did the Pharisees try to do? The Pharisees tried to put Jesus in a frame. What was their frame? The frame was, if you fit in to the pattern that we have in mind, then you are right. If you don't fit in to the pattern that we have in our mind, you are out. Now, brothers and sisters, when we come to the Lord, some of our frames have some limitations. Some of our frames we have in our mind most definitely will blind you. Now, if we are to see correctly, the Pharisees had to remove their frames. Now let's look at some of the frames we have in our mind. Now we may not have a frame about the Sabbath, but we may have a frame about the time that things will happen. Now how many of you, if you failed something, if something went wrong in your life, said, one day, I know everything will come right. Okay? One day, everything will come right. You have been asked to quit a job. One day will come when I can prove myself. I failed an exam. One day will come when they will ask me what to do, because one day will come. Now how many of you, I don't want you to lift hands, but ask me a question, how many of you have said one day? And the first person is, I have said so. One day will come when I can prove myself. Now brothers and sisters, when it comes to faith, there are some counterfeits about faith. Now, is positive thinking faith? What do you say? Have you heard the word positive thinking? Have you? Is positive thinking faith? Or is optimism faith? These are very difficult questions. Is there a difference? Yes, there is a difference, I say now. Because many people go for positive thinking and optimism rather than faith, and they don't get their result. Because optimism and positive thinking both have their receiving or their goal in the future. Whereas faith has its receiving now. Let me explain to you. Let me explain to you from Mark 11 verse 24. Hold your peace, I'm explaining to you. Mark 11 24, let's read it. Therefore, I say to you, all things which you pray and ask, believe that you have received them, and they will be granted you. This word receive, is it in the future, present, or past? It looks in the past. It's not in the future, of course. Because many people, if you look at this story, what happened is Jesus, we will come to it a little later, Jesus spat on the ground, he made balls of clay, applied on this man's two eyes, and he said, go and wash yourself in the pool of Siloam, and you will receive sight. And what did this man do? This man, as soon as Jesus applied the clay on the eyes, believed, I have received my healing. And now what needs to be done? Only washed in the pool of Siloam. And that man received the healing as soon as Jesus touched him. If you want faith, when do you receive the healing or your answer? Does that mean that the manifestation also will happen just now? It may or it may not. But when do you receive it? Now. Right, let's look at 2 Corinthians 6 verse 2. 2 Corinthians 6 verse 2. For he says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Now, during the course of this day, at the end of this message, we are going to call for healings, for prayer, for anything that you need from God. And when will you receive this? Now. You need to hold on what you have received. Believe that you have received. Thank God for what you have received. Hold on to it for some time and you will have it. Understood? Because faith is now. The moment you say, in the by and by, God will do this for me, that is optimism and not faith. Don't trust your optimism to bring results. It will not bring results. If you have faith, receive that answer now from God and say, thank you, God. I have received it by faith. Right, let's go. Now, what was the first topic I discussed with you? The side of belief. The side of belief. The moment you believe God for something greater, you get the answer and you see the world differently. The side of belief. Right? Let's look at the second one, the side of action. Let's read from John chapter 9, verses 6 to 7. When he had said these things, he spat on the ground and made clay with saliva. And he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. And he said to him, go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which is translated sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. Now, dear brothers and sisters, when did this man receive the healing? This is very important for us to understand. Many will think he got the healing when he washed in the pool of Siloam and his eyes were opened. How many of you believe that? I believe that all this time. I thought the point of healing was there, but that is wrong. The point of healing was when Jesus touched his eyes, he received the healing, the fullness of healing by faith. And he had to do something for the full manifestation of what he has received. Today, you would have come with a problem. You would have come with an issue. I want every one of you to receive that answer by faith. When is faith active? It is active now. Now I want you to, if you have come here for the first time or the second time, this what I'm telling you now will be a little confusing to you. But if you don't understand this, please don't misunderstand me or please forget about it. God does not live in the realm of time. He lives in the realm called eternity. If it is difficult for you to understand, forget about it. God does not live in the realm of time. For us, we have a beginning, we have an end, and there is a transit time between those two. But for God, the future is now, the past is now, and the present is also now. So when he says, I answered you, what will happen to us in the future, for God is now. When God says, I have healed your past, it has happened sometime back, but for God it's now. It's a little confusing to understand, but if you know that, you will understand when God gives, he gives now, right now. Though your answer may come in the future. God lives in eternity where there is no time. Right, let's come back to the story. Let's come back. Let's look at Romans 12 verse 3. Romans 12 verse 3. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more high than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. Now repeat with me, God has given me a measure of faith. Which means, when God gave faith, there is faith in your heart. Whether you like it or not, You have faith in your heart. Why? God has given you that measure of faith. So when Jesus said to the blind man, you go and wash yourself, he had the ability to believe that he has received his sight, and he had the ability to go there and wash himself so that he can completely see. How many of you? He had the faith. Why did he have a faith? Because God has given to everyone faith. Right? Now, if we turn to James chapter 2, verses 20 and 24, 20 to 24, this is a very important passage. You have faith, but your faith could be dead, or your faith could be complete. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled which says, Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see then that a man is justified by works and not only by faith. If you have faith but you don't have the actions related to that faith, what is that faith called? Dead faith. What is dead faith? Faith which is not active. Faith which is of no use. Faith which will not profit you. But if you have faith and you couple it with works, what does it say? That is called complete faith. So that whenever we pray for you and you want to receive your healing, say there is a pain on your right hip. When I was praying, I felt that there is somebody who has a pain on your right hip. And it's difficult for you sometimes maybe to bend that part, place, but if you believe and receive your healing by faith, and you check out yourself and see, is the pain there? What are you doing? You're checking yourself with words, and that pain will depart from you, because that is complete faith. If you have a problem and you pray to God, Lord, I need to receive, and you believe that you have received it from God, it is time to put that faith into action. Students, if you have an exam and you want good results, you want to ask God to give you good marks, receive that, believe that, and go ahead with your studies at full force. Faith must always be coupled with words. If you want your marriage whole, and you're praying for your wife or your husband, receive that and treat your wife or husband like the apple of your eye. Go ahead with your words. You want to be a good son. You feel that you're not a good son, but you want to be a good son. You receive that. Go ahead with the words. If you want a promotion, receive it from God. And go ahead doing your work without complaining, without murmuring, without telling nasty things about your boss or subordinates. Go ahead with it. And have your works, because faith with works is complete faith. This is why, first is the belief of side of belief, second is the side of action. You need to couple it with action. Right. Now, okay. Now, what are some of the actions that you need to take? Sometimes you would want healing for some area of your life, not only physical. And God may reveal to you, you need to forgive your husband. You need to forgive your husband. And you want that blessing from God, but God says, my daughter, you need to forgive your husband. The moment you forgive, that blessing will come alive in your life. Okay? Let's look at another action we could take. Romans chapter 10 verses 8 to 11. Proverbs chapter 10 verses 8 to 11. 10, 8 to 11. But what does it say? The word is near you in your mouth and your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. And if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. You want your life to change dramatically? You want to get rid out of your addictions? Some of these addictions are smoking and gambling and alcohol. But sometimes these addictions are in your mind realm, like watching pornography, anger, bad-mouthing people. These are all addictions. People have so many addictions in life. And you need a change of yourself. What you need to do? You need to believe that Jesus died for you on the cross, paid the penalty for your sin, and believe that your sins are forgiven you, that God raised you from the dead, face with your mouth, Jesus, you are my Lord. You believe, you have the action of saying that in your mouth, from that day onwards, that addiction is broken over your life. You're free. Faith coupled with action. One final scripture which I can give the projectionist, Matthew 7, 7 and 8. Let's read this. Matthew 7, 7 and 8. With that, I would like to come to a close. Matthew 7, verses 7 and 8. Let's read this together. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. And he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened to you. These are the very words of Jesus. He says, ask and it shall be given to you. Verse 8, for everyone. Are you a first time newcomer here? This is for you. Have you been involved in a sin last week? Is this for you? This is for you. Or were you a failure just today, a few hours ago? Is this for you? This is for you. Are you not a Christian? Is this for you? This is for you. Otherwise, it won't be everyone. Are you here today? You are included in everyone. Just about a year ago, there was a woman who had both kidneys failing. And usually the kidney function, per kidney functions about 60%. And this lady's kidney functions dropped to 15%. Both kidneys were functioning 15%, and what you call end-stage renal failure. And and she has to be dialyzed about twice a week. She has to be given erythropoietin injections to boost her red cell growth because there's a hormone called erythropoietin from the kidneys which help your blood circulation, production of red cells. She couldn't eat meat, she was a diabetic. And one fine day she came to a service, a Christian service. And this, on the time of ministry, she was not a Christian. And while hands were being laid, she received a blessing for, she received a prayer. The next week she went to the doctor, and the doctor said, these can't be your results. Maybe there's a fault with the results. And she took the results again. And the doctor said, I can't believe your results. Because she was dialyzed twice a week. Praise God. Dialysis was stopped. No erythropoietin injections. Diabetes healed. Kidney functions rose to 60% on both kidneys. She could eat proteins. Her life completely healed. And you may wonder, this would have happened in many meetings or in Nigeria. But do you know where this miracle happened? In the midst of this problem. That is the power of receiving from God. Praise God. The power of receiving from God, and everyone who asks shall receive. Today, do you want anything from God? Is the question. If you want anything from God, if you have the audacity to believe God now, is the answer given. You will receive it. But hang on to it, for in the near future, the answer will see the light of day. And I just want to end this passage by reading John 9 verses 35 to 38. John 9 verses 35 to 38. Jesus heard that they had cast him out. What happened? Because this man was healed on the Sabbath and he esteemed the Lord Jesus very high, this man was put out of the synagogue. And Jesus comes to this man the second time. And Jesus says to this man, Jesus heard that they had cast him out. And when he had found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of God? He answered and said, who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him? And Jesus said to him, you have both seen him, and it is he who is talking with you. Then he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshipped him. Jesus came the first time to bring about a healing, to give, so that you, that man could receive. Second time Jesus came so that man could latch on to Jesus a little more. That man, I would like the worship team to come. That man could know about Jesus a little bit more. That he could be a worshiper of Jesus. A worshiper of God. Dear brothers, today you would have come here maybe to receive your miracle. Today, if you have come to receive your miracle, please receive your miracle. But for some, it is not merely a miracle that Jesus is coming to meet you for, but he is coming to meet you to bring you a little closer to him. And I want you to respond to Jesus. Shall we rise to our feet as the organ is being played? Okay, don't worry. You take your time. Let's rise to our feet. And let's call upon the name of the Lord for everyone who asks, receives. Father, we thank you and we bless your name. Father, I pray that none will go out of this place without receiving. And none will lose out on this opportunity to receive from the Father in heaven. Lord, we thank you and we bless your name. And I want you to raise your prayers to him. I want you to let God know about the prayer and the request you need. I want you to pray to him right now. As you pray, receive the answer now. Today is the day of salvation. Yes, let the organ play, let the keyboards play. Today is the day of salvation for you. Today is the acceptable time for him. He is here to give you more than you can ask. Before Jesus went to heaven, Jesus told his disciples, "My friends, up to this time you have not asked me anything, but ask that your joy may be full." He's not a miserly God who is waiting to punish your every sin. He's a generous God waiting to give you life. Father, we thank you and we worship you, Lord. Father, I pray that none will go out of this place thinking in the sweet by and by I will receive this now. That is positive thinking. Today is the day for you to receive. Open your heart wide. Receive. Some of you need to believe that your sins are forgiven. You need to confess that Jesus is the Lord of your life. And I want you to do it now. Believe that he rose from the dead. He paid for your sin. He died. And your sins are forgiven. And he rose victoriously. Believe that. Confess with your mouth, Jesus, you are my Lord. You are my master.
day of salvation for you.
This prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I come before you today and I believe that you have forgiven all my sin. Father, give me a new leaf in my life, Lord. And I pray that you will change me. Lord, that you will deliver me from all the addictions and all the sins of my life. And I now confess that you are the Lord of my life. If you need prayer, this is the Miracle Sunday. And I want the altar call team to come forward, please. If I can ask Pastor Usha to come and pray. Please do come forward. None of you should go without receiving from God today.
Father, we just want to thank you for this evening. Thank you for the word of God that was broken before us, Lord. Thank you, Father, that today the eyes of the blind was opened, Lord. Father, tonight we thank you because now we can see with the eyes that you have given us, Lord. The eyes that are full of light, Father, we thank you because, Lord, that our eyes are carrying the light of God, Father. And we thank you that each one of us have been given a measure of faith, Lord. Now let that measure of faith be stirred upon the hearts of your people as they take a step to come up to the altar. Beloved, today you are coming up to the altar responding to the message by saying that this is the work that I come up to receive the healing. And I go back and when I'm believing on the healing as the word has been given, it shall happen to you. Even as that man who came up and was prayed upon and the mud was put on his eyes and he went back to wash his face in the pool of Shiloh. He put his faith into action. Now it's the time. Are you ready to put the faith into action? What is the breakthrough you need? What is it that you want? Because the word of God says, ask, and for everyone who asks, it shall be given. Unless you come up and ask the Lord, it won't happen, beloved. So it's a time that you can step out. Come to the altar. 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 It can be so small an issue, but no issue is small to the Lord. Because he cares for everyone. He loves everyone. He wants to set everyone free. He wants to heal everyone. Because he died for everyone on the cross. And when he gave his life upon the cross, he said, it is finished. It is finished. It is done. And it is already given and finished. So all what you need has already been given unto you. Even as Jehan shared, it is right now for the Lord. What was done in the past is now for the Lord. What is doing for the future is now for the Lord. He is seeing us because he is the same God yesterday, today and forevermore. He changes not. He is same. Father, we thank you that we serve a God who is ever faithful. We thank you, Lord, that your mercies are new every morning. And this day, Lord, we thank you because your mercy will come upon your people. Father, we pray that even as they have made their way to the altar, that Lord, that you will hear the cry of their heart, that you are a God who sees, you are a God who hears, you are a God who feels, and you are a God of compassion. May the compassion heart of Jesus Christ come upon every person tonight and touch the very need of every heart, Lord. The Lord and everyone who has stood up here at the altar is a person who is saying, Lord, I need your touch. Lord, I need your touch. Lord, I need your touch. And Father, even as they cry, asking for the touch this evening, I pray, Lord, that you will come and touch every needy heart, every needy person. And Lord, you will fulfill every desire in their heart. That Lord, you will answer every question that they may have. Lord, we thank you because you are a God who answers us, Lord. Father, this evening I pray, Lord, that their spiritual eyes will be opened, that they will see, Lord, all what you have kept for them, Lord. Father, we want to thank you, Lord, because he who is in us is greater than the one in the world. And Father, tonight, even as your people come and stand before you, that Lord, that the assurance that they have, that the Lord Jesus Christ who is in them is greater than anyone in the world. So Father, tonight I pray, may the presence of God come and overshadow them. May the word of God come in season for them. May the promise of God be fulfilled even as they receive, believe, and go forth. That Lord, that miracle will manifest upon their lives. Father, we thank you. Sometimes we have to wait for a day. Sometimes we have to wait for a week. Sometimes we have to wait even for a month or even longer. Whatever it may be, Lord, there is one thing for sure, that as we keep believing, as we keep walking, as we keep trusting, and as we keep thanking you, that all what you have for us will come to pass. So I pray tonight, Lord, that if anyone is feeling condemned, I feel there is someone, or maybe more than one, who is feeling condemned, thinking you have erred. But the word of God says there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is no condemnation. There is no condemnation. You heard Jehan speaking about, saying, they ask, whose sin is this? Is the father's sin, mother's sin, or whose sin? Why is this situation like this? But the Lord said, no, none of that. But it is for my glory to be experienced in your life. Tonight, if you believe, you will experience God's glory upon your life. You will experience God healing upon your life. You will experience God's deliverance in your life. You will experience the joy that comes from knowing Him. The joy that comes in knowing Him. And you will experience a peace that passes all understanding. It's the peace. Because Jesus came, I came to give you peace. And he said, I leave this peace with you. And tonight, even at this altar as you come forth, may the Lord speak to you in your need and give you peace in your heart so that you may believe that what you have asked for, God has answered. In Jesus' precious name.
If you are sick in your body, I want you to keep your hand on the place where you are sick. If you have a elbow pain, a left elbow pain, I want you to keep your hand on the left elbow. If it is you, if your eyes are sick, I want you to keep your hand over there. And while we are praying, if you cannot keep your hand, I just want you to keep your hand over your head. But I want every one of you to receive and to receive. If you have a problem which is not a sickness, I want you to just lift your hands in surrender to God. And I want you to just receive the answer, receive the assurance. This is the altar where you meet face to face with God. I want you to receive it right now. Don't hurry. Receive. There'll be an inner peace that comes into your heart. Just enjoy that inner peace. Receive it right now.
Go. bodies right now. What? Do something that you cannot do. Receive your healing. If you receive the healing, I want you to tell, when you come to the altar, please tell the person who will pray for you. Because we would like to hear what God has done for you. Father, we just want to thank you, God. We rebuke the sicknesses. We rebuke the devourers out of their life. We bless you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, give them the assurance that you are with them. Give them the assurance that everyone who asks receives today, now. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you. Now, the altar call team will proceed to pray for you. And when the person prays for you, we expect the Lord to work wonders.